my pack, my tribe. Welcome to Howling After Dark. Got a very cool show tonight. We're going to be going to some video evidence. And this is also going to be part lecture, I guess. Talking about things like how to properly, in my opinion anyways, catch video evidence and photographic evidence. As well as looking at some of the stuff that me and my team have captured, both recently and in the past. And I've got absolutely no one in chat, so tell you what, here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna wait and give it about 10 minutes or so. If nobody's here, I'm just gonna end this thing, and we'll do it another night. Oh, there's Jeremy. Hey, Jer. If you look on our website here, gustloparra.weebly.com, on the live streaming radio and web series page, down below chat, there's three YouTube videos. And I posted these not just for video evidence, but also because I think they teach some valuable lessons. Now the first one that says file 0002, and if you play that, right in the beginning, there's a spot where I'm looking at this window. Where we're at, by the way, is in the Mansfield Farm Museum in this this area that that's made to look just like a 1930s, 1940s soda shop. What you'll see is it looks kind of like there's a figure in the window there, and really there's not. And the way that we what you'll see is the way that I debunk it is you'll see me, I'm looking at the window, and it kind of looks like there's a figure there. But then I do this thing where I kind of pan back and forth, or what I call a short pan. It's just where I've got the camera like so, right? And all I do is I just kind of go like this. It doesn't take a lot. It just takes a little bit. And that figure's still there, and it hasn't moved. And that tells me that it's not actually there. That it's basically like pareidolia, which is the mind making sense of things that aren't really there, I guess is the best way to put it. But and as far as that first video is concerned, that's really all that that I saw, anyways, in it that was of note, that I thought it would be worth bringing up tonight. Now, the next file down, the second video, I find a bit more interesting because I don't know how well you'll be able to see it on this video, but it was just me and my our EVP specialist Becca, and we were up in the attic in the Farm Museum, and the way the Farm Museum's set up is like on one side there's the Farm Museum, and then next door there's like this bingo hall, and above the bingo hall there's an attic that kind of runs around like in an L shape, and we were up in that attic, which as you can see in the video they use for storage, but we had a laser grid up, I had my my infrared camera, and we could visibly see, both me and Becca could visibly see a shadow figure going back and forth, disturbing the laser dots. Oh, and coincidentally, the other thing that was cool that was going on the entire time is I had this app. Here, I'll show you what it looks like. It's the same app I did for my EVP show. It's called the GB1 or Ghost Fox 1. It was invented by my buddy Danny, who owns Big Beard Studio. See, so that's what it looks like. And that was running the whole time, and we're actually getting responses to stuff at the same time. Now this is about an 8-minute clip, so if you'd like to watch it with me, go ahead and click play now. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and pause this at about 1 minute and 15 seconds in, right on the, right near the bottom of the screen. You see like, it looks like some boxes on the floor, and then there's like these 3 or 4 laser dots that go across, kind of like diagonally, and then there's one above the one in the middle. And it momentarily got blocked out. It could have been just an insect, I don't know. But I just thought I'd point that out.
Are you guys right, saying this to us, or are you talking? calling me a bastard, were you? I don't know who Newton is. Was he a firefighter?
There, it's just before 4:50. We get something about a poodle named Newton. Now, I've been going to this place for a long time. We've been going there pretty regular for about two, almost 3 years now, and never once came across the spirit of a poodle named Newton. So I'm not sure. I think the spirits up in this attic area, for whatever reason, are predominantly what I call transient spirits. They don't really haunt the place. They're just kind of traveling through. So I think whoever this particular spirit was that we were talking to was looking for this dog named Newton. And Newton, for all I know, could still be alive somewhere. Could have outlived its owner, for all I know. But it was interesting. Because, you know, a lot of these spirits, they'll go to places for all sorts of random reasons. I came across a spirit one time that was trying to reunite with his high school sweetheart that he hadn't seen for about 20 years prior to his death. Stuff like that happens. And that's the thing about spirits. Much like with people, you never know what somebody's going to really care about. And I do believe in animal spirits too, by the way. I kind of have to. my dog Lobo is still with me today, even though it's been 30 years since he died, and I have been visited by my first dog. My very first dog was a dog named Buck, he was kind of a mutt, but I loved that dog, and I still think about him from time to time, because I really love that dog. That was my first dog, and he unfortunately got hit by a truck and died. In this third video, once again, we were in the soda shop, and the reason why it looks so black here in the beginning isn't because, you know, my illuminator died or anything like that. It was simply because we had a flashlight that was going on and off, and I turned my IR light because it'll appear better that way on video. And that's like another lesson, I guess, in paranormal film work, I guess I should say, that I want people to be aware of. You always gotta play around with your surroundings, and also with whatever phenomena is going on. Like if you have a light going on and off, it's probably best to turn the IR light off, just because it's going to show up better on film. Because it's going to give that dark contrast, so that when it pops on, you can see it better. Unfortunately, for whatever reason, the spirit in question didn't want to cooperate with me. So, here we go. Playing the third file, it's called File 0003. It's about 1:32 long, so I'm just going to play in its entirety. And here we go.
Johnny, can you do me a favor and turn that light on?
Hold on 1 second. I'm going to go ahead and pause that for a second because I just saw something in chat I want to respond to. Very loyal, very cool person that listens to my show is Mr. Jeremy Henry. He's tuned in to practically every show I've ever done. I met him initially in Darkness Radio. A real cool cat. And when I was talking about you know, the whole dark spirit thing, he says, that's awesome, I believe they visit us. I have a cat that is still around. Now, I love that, actually, that, you know, I still get visited occasionally by my cat, Dusty. Dusty was such an awesome cat. She was a gray tabby. Or not tabby, but she was like all gray, and she had like just this like diamond-shaped tuft of white fur on her chest, and then little white socks on her feet, and she was awesome. She was such a loving cat, and she was outside one day, and our neighbor backed his truck into her. Because he didn't see her, and she survived for a long time. We took her to the vet, and they did a surgery on her pelvic bone. But unfortunately, I guess whatever doctor we took her to was kind of a quack, and he didn't do it correctly. So when her pelvic bone fused back together, it didn't do it correctly, and it developed a condition over a period of time, which she eventually died of. But I still hear her sometimes and feel her. Like there's one of her favorite things to do is I sleep on my stomach a lot, right? So like one of her favorite things to do was to like kind of like jump up on my back and curl up and go to sleep on top of me. And I still feel her do that from time to time. So, yeah, that's very cool. Alright, continuing on. As you see in this video, we're at 34 seconds in, and it's still dark. But I believe I'm about to turn the light on, so here we go. Starting now.
Still here, can you turn the light on, Donnie? anybody else here besides Donnie?
And there you have it. I guess I didn't show me turn the light on in that clip. Well, I'm a big animal guy in general. I just lean a little bit more towards dogs. But my cat now, Logan, I love that cat to death. That's like my furry little son, that guy is. And I named him Logan because he's got like this black mask over his eyes, and it reminds me of Wolverine from the comic books. You know, Wolverine, Logan. And he's just awesome. He's so cool. And what's funny is because we live in a house that's haunted, is watching his reactions to stuff sometimes, because he'll, like, you know, follow him around with his gaze. It's amusing a lot of the time. And I've actually, it's always late at night when this happens. I don't know why. Usually around 3:30 or so in the morning, I'll go downstairs if I'm still awake, which I usually am, to get some coffee, and I'll like go downstairs, and my cat is playing with something that, well, I see it, of course. I know it's dusty, but like I know that if other people were awake, if they would see my cat playing with some imaginary friend. Yeah, exactly. I have no doubt they do. Jeremy said in chat, I do believe my other cats see the one that passed away too. And I have no doubt that they do. I think it's something about innocence, as well as something about because the visual acuity of like animals as well as children. Because it's actually been proven that a child's eyesight is much more like that of like a cat or a dog when they're very young, because their visual acuity is attracted to like movement and other things that we can't explain. And cats, you know, cats and dogs and other animals, they never lose that. Like we do. And by we, I mean humans. He says they play at like 3 or 4 a.m. and he's seen that himself. So, it's not an uncommon thing at all. So just be aware of that, you know. I would say to anybody, if your animals are acting, you know, a little odd, maybe there's something going on you don't know. Because they see and sense things that we don't. And I think that's tied into their whole instincts. And I think that's, in some ways, I would say the animals are far superior to us. Like the way that animals can sense disasters before they happen. Which, yes, I realize some people can too, but animals are far better at it than we are. One of my dogs, when I was growing up and during my high school years in California, we had this dog named Sandy, and she was adorable. She visits me too, by the way. She was very cute. I mean, so adorable. And it's really kind of messed up how I got her. I was walking home from school one day, and some jerk off had dumped her in a plastic bag in the middle of the road. Had I not come along and saw this like black bag moving in the middle of the street, she probably would have died right then and there. And I had a friend with me, and we went up, and I opened the bag, and I brought her home. I mean, it was like right next to my house, basically. And I brought her home, and we just kept her. But I called her Sandy because she was a mix of Golden Retriever and Cocker Spaniel. And she had the kind of floppy ears like a Cocker Spaniel does, but the golden hair like a Golden Retriever, except for it was shorter hair. And she was so cute. She was so adorable and such a lover. And just a great dog. And so that's how I got her. I had her for the longest time. She was really old when she finally passed away. Her hair was actually starting to turn white. So she was probably about 10-ish, maybe 15 years old. Which is, you know, that's like top range of age for most dogs. And she passed away, and I see her, like, I think she visits both me and my mom. And the weird thing about that is I think distance means nothing to them, because my mom lives in Denver. She died in California. My mom lives in Denver, and I live here in Ohio. And I think she goes back and forth, because my mom also really adored that dog. And I would have, by the way, I would have a dog right now if I could, but I can't, because this apartment I live in doesn't allow dogs over 25 pounds, and I'm a big dog guy. I don't do the little ankle biters. I love them, don't get me wrong, but I just don't do them. They have a lot of health issues that I can't handle that, because they don't live very long. Most of your small breeds, there are a few exceptions, like my granddad's dachshund Trixie lived to be almost 30 years old. Extremely long for a dog. That would be like somebody living to be, you know, like 150. You know, in dog years, of course. But that dog was cool. That was a cool dog too. But she got real snappy in her old age. But yeah, most small dog breeds don't live very long, and they have other issues like. I would trust a pit bull over a poodle any day of the week. Any day of the week, people. I'm serious. Poodles will snap and turn on you quicker than a pit bull ever could. And the whole stigma about pit bulls, in my opinion, by the way, is total bullshit. Some of the most loving, you know, very family oriented, very just loving and kind and naturally forgiving dogs I've ever seen were pit bulls. Them and like huskies and German shepherds and stuff. But French poodle, they are so inbred that they've got a genetic disorder in their brain. And they don't get very old before they start to snap. And there's been more cases of people being attacked by poodle than there have been by pit bull. You just don't hear about it, because he wants to admit that they were, you know, they got their arm taken off by a poodle. Nobody, you know. So, yeah. Anyways. there are other little subtle things that you learn to do after a while with the camera to kind of debunk stuff while you're filming. Like the short pan, like I showed you with the first video. Or as I like to do it, I like to call it panning for gold, because when you do that, it strengthens whatever you do catch, first of all. We've gotten full-blown apparitions and full-blown shadow figures and caught the movement because of stuff like that. The other thing, and this is actually a lot trickier than people are aware of, is to have your camera pointed wherever you're looking. I know it sounds easy, but it actually really isn't. And the reason that you can prove that is, like, if you watch, like, the ghost hunting shows, like Ghost Adventures, for example, how many times has stuff been missed on their cameras because they were looking a different direction than where the camera was pointing? Quite a bit. So what I do is, like, the way I typically hold it, and you can tell in some of my videos because they look like they were shot from a very low angle, is I actually hold it like this. Like, it's in front of me and I'm gripping it from underneath like this. And that's why it looks that way. But what it does is, like, I can, you know, and pan my body with the camera. A lot of people have an easier time with, like, a shoulder setup, and I would love to have one of those. I just don't have one. Or you can. But the problem with this is the camera literally blocks half of your vision. Half of your peripheral vision is gone when you have a shoulder setup, where the camera is literally here blocking everything on one side of you. So even then, I would hold it from underneath. You know, and I've tried to get better about, you know, holding it higher. But you know how it is. You know, after a while, your arms get tired. So I promise you, I'm not trying to perv out on people or anything like that. It's just, I'm not really thinking about it, to be honest. And by the way, I apologize, I have a bit of a cold, so I'm a little sniffly tonight. Other thing that you can do, and is like pre-panning. And what pre-panning is, it's really simple. If you've ever been on a ghost hunt, and like, you've had a camera, right, and you're going down a hallway, and all of a sudden you hear a sound behind you, what most people do is they'll turn around, right? And what happens is, a lot of the time, is, like, when they turn around, something happens in front of them at the same time they're hearing the sound, because spirits are trying to distract you a lot of the time. So because some of them are very camera shy, they don't want to be caught on film. So what I've learned to do is, like, I hear something behind me. I'm going, like, down a hallway, right? I hear something behind me. What I'll do is I'll keep my eyes forward, but I'll pre-pan. And then look. And I'll look sideways like this, so I can keep my eyes on both angles. That way, if something happens over here, I can just, like so. And, you know, others may have different different things that they do. Yeah, I've thought about doing a GoPro, but GoPros have issues, like I'm saying too. Like if something's happening over here and I look over here because there's a sound over here, I'm gonna miss what happened over here. So it's kind of the same thing. And yeah, they do make actually camera mounted helmets, or they actually have this thing. It's like a GoPro like headband thing. And I have actually I'm about to go off on a little something, and I'm sure it wasn't intentional. So, but you know, it's just one of those things. A while back, I came up with an idea for a device, a camera device, that I called the Magic Sensor. And basically, what it is, it's kind of a cube, right? And inside the cube, there's like lining one side of each side of the cube is like eight like fish eye camera lenses, and each one is something different. So I'd go like full spectrum, IR, thermal, and standard, let's say, and it would be on each side all the way around. Now what it would do is it would be able to give you 360 degree from floor to ceiling coverage in the center of a room. And then the way I was going to design it is so that like there'd be like little switches on top, and you pull the switches and they would disconnect into four separate pieces that you can set in corners of a room and cover the whole room from floor to ceiling. But if you've been watching Ghost Adventures and Ghost Hunters and stuff, you know that a guy recently came out with basically a bastardized version of it, where there's cameras on top of like this circular thing, but these are like standard digital cameras. Same concept. I kind of feel like he got the idea from me and just kind of bastardized it. That's just my honest opinion. I don't know if he actually did or not. But, it's like when you come up with an idea and then you see that somebody is already doing it. You know, it's that kind of thing. Anyways, let me bring it up, because what you said about the GoPro 365 or 360 or whatever, that kind of reminded me of it. So, anyways. Yeah, there are things that you can do like that. I would suggest, if you were going to get a GoPro, like mounted on a shoulder or on a headband or whatever, that you also use an additional camera as well. That way you can keep everything covered. Because a lot of the time we miss a lot of stuff because we're paying attention to sounds, or we're paying attention to whatever's going on, and we're missing the other things that are going on that we don't even know. And I think if you're aware of that kind of stuff and that kind of behavior, you catch a lot more. And I know this is kind of like boastful, I guess, but one thing I can honestly say about my team is, like, we've never walked away from an investigation empty-handed, ever. And I think it's in our approach and in our methodology. Like, it's just how we think about stuff. Thanks. Jeremy says, cool idea. I think it would work great. I agree. I think it would. You know, and there are other ideas I have that, you know, I'm not going to talk about because I don't want somebody ripping off, but things like we've all seen video of spirits pushing a ball around on a floor. How great would it be if you had a ball in an empty room, and inside the ball there was a camera that saw everything all the way around, floor to ceiling? That would be pretty amazing. So I kind of came up with an idea similar to that. But actually, I have my camcorder, well, one of the camcorders I use right here. So, usually, as you can see, it's got this handy little display screen, okay? And usually what I'll do is, you can see right here, there's this thing on the bottom that allows me to connect an arm. It's like this arm that comes out like that, and then the illuminator light, it's just an infrared or full spectrum light that comes out on top, is right there, and then I can hold the sidearm, or I can hold it like this, and have full extension with my arm, and that's typically, you know, how I hold it. There are times when I'll actually hold it like this, so like my eyes aren't paying attention to anything but the screen, which for me personally, that's not ideal, because I like to hold it a little bit farther down, you know, so I can still see the screen in like my lower peripheral, but I'm paying attention to everything around me. And the cool thing about it is this one in particular, It was about $250 when I bought it. It's a Bell & Howell infrared night vision camera, full HD. It's got a zoom feature on it. It can take still shots as well as video. And it's infrared, so I'm going to try and show you what infrared looks like on this thing. Like, that's infrared. I don't know how well you can see it. Let me look real quick, make sure I'm getting it. Yeah, so, like, if anything crosses the screen, if you see, like, that's my hand right there, and it kind of, like, brightens the screen when it passes. Well, the same thing happens with spirits, because it'll kind of brighten the screen like that, so even if I'm not looking directly at the screen, my eyesight, like, it's lower than where my eyes are looking, but it's high enough so that, like, when something passes, that little glow of something passing the screen will actually be caught in my peripheral vision, and I'll know, oh, well, I need to stop and review that part. You know, and I try and review as much as I can on the scene, so I know, like, which file actually has something on it, which, you know, just helps in the whole editing process. That's the other thing too. But most people, what they want to do is they want to. There's a lot of teams out there putting together, video from ghost hunts and stuff. And typically, what they'll do is they'll cut when they're editing just the pieces that have stuff in it that they can visibly see. I, however, don't do that. I don't believe in it. I really don't. Mainly because, like, it's too easy for skeptical people to say that the film's been doctored or whatever. So, like, with our web series, I don't even watch the footage before I put it together and release it on YouTube. At all. I don't even watch it. In fact, until earlier today, I had no idea what was in the video clips we just watched. Other than the fact that I was, you know, there. I obviously knew there was going to be something in certain parts, but I didn't know for sure, you know, what would be where. And I think that lends it a certain authenticity, personally. But if you are the type that wants to edit film, whether we're talking paranormal or not, there are certain ways to do that that are better than others. YouTube is actually really good. They have their own editor on YouTube that works really well, and you can cut film on it. Down to like the exact second that you want it. So they're really good. But there are other programs that you can get. Movie Maker is another good one for Windows. If you don't want to download a program, there's some that are available online. One's called Loopster. If you go to loopster.com, you can sign up and create videos from there, and there's lots of different things you can do with that one. The only like downside to the website ones is your videos can only be like so big, like can't be over like I think it's like a gig. They can't be a gig in size on Loopster, I think. There's another one called WeVideo. They're really good. It was a really nice one that I loved. All my earlier videos were made with it, called Pixorial. Unfortunately, they went under, so they're not around anymore. But yeah, so if you don't want to download anything, there are online options for it, so just be aware of that. But like I said, I don't really edit anything unless I'm trying to make a clip to like promote something, or like tonight, I did, because I didn't want the videos to be too long. The longest one I had up actually was the second video that was up in the attic of the Farm Museum. It's like 8 minutes long. And if you paid attention during that, I'm sure you probably saw some shadow movement or cut something blocking out some of those lasers on the grid. So there you have it. Thank you for bringing that up. Jeremy just asked in chat, did you go to the Ohio Paranormal meeting? It was actually the Ohio Paranormal Gathering was the name of it. And yes, I did. I was actually speaker there. I talked about forgotten places, you know, places that are overlooked because they haven't been on TV yet. Ghost towns, mainly, I covered. And I had pictures to show, but it was actually really cool. And I think someone who's going to turn out to be a good friend actually contacted me today about a case he's working on that I met there. No, I didn't get to tape it because unfortunately all I had with me was my cell phone, and the only service I have on my cell phone at the moment is Wi-Fi, and there was no Wi-Fi there that I could use, so unfortunately I didn't get to tape it. But I did take pictures, which I will be posting later, that were pretty cool. A lot of cool. Both years I've been there now, because this is only the second annual one. People have been really cool. There were some people that canceled, unfortunately. That happens, and I was the last speaker, and unfortunately by then a lot of people had already left. It was good. It was pretty much a packed house there at the beginning, but a bunch of people had to leave because a lot of people had different stuff going on, and including us, we had a hunt at the farm museum that night, which was Saturday night. That's where these videos I just showed are from. The videos below the chat, and it was a great night, actually. Reagan and Abby were both there. They unfortunately didn't get to do the investigation with us, but I understood. And they'd be here tonight, except for Reagan just got a new job and she just got home, so that's why they're not here. I'm not sure why no one else is here, but it was all good, man. Good times. Nora Custer, who is the arranger of the event, she pays for the venue out of pocket. That's just further testament of how amazing she is. And both times I've been there, we've made great friends. Last year I was there, I met my buddies at HPI, that's a paranormal team out of Upper Sandusky, and they're awesome. We've investigated with them a couple times now, and good stuff. Adam Kramer, another guy that we met, he's out of Cleveland. He just got the Franklin Castle. That's his baby now, basically. He's doing the ghost hunt search, so that's awesome stuff. And it's just all good. All good stuff. I can't say enough about it. It was. Jeremy said, nice, glad it went well. Sounds like a good time. And it was. It was awesome. Met a lot of great people. Got to see a lot of people I met from the last one that were awesome. Made some new friends as well, and couldn't be happier. I'm actually a little surprised that more people aren't tuned in tonight, because I told them all about this, and so who knows, maybe next time we'll tune in. Anyways, moving on. I do also have a similar camera to this, actually, that I think it's Panasonic or something, but it's a full spectrum camera. And the difference between a night vision full spectrum, by the way, if you don't know, is infrared obviously sees an infrared spectrum. Full spectrum sees in both ultraviolet and infrared at the same time. So it actually catches a lot of stuff that an IR would miss. But IR is still very useful because it's always good to have both, period. Because even though it's full spectrum, a full spectrum camera is going to tend to catch more in one range or the other. Even though it can see in both, there's like images it catches, like mine, images it catches in ultraviolet are going to be far more crisp and succinct than things that it catches in infrared. And so to have an infrared camera as well is a really good thing. It allows you to catch things that a full spectrum might catch, but not with the clarity that an infrared camera is going to catch it. I would love to have a straight ultraviolet camera as well, but they're expensive, so I don't have one. that's basically it. It's also good to have like still cameras too. Like my investigator Becky just got a brand new still camera, digital still camera, so that's good. And that gets us covered there. And she's already caught some great photographs. With me, I don't have anything like that. I just got my camera and on my phone, and then my digital cameras, which both can take still shots. I just don't typically. Although I have sometimes. But I do have a camera on here, but it's just, you know, normal vision. But here's a, I don't know if you can see it, but there's a picture of the paranormal gathering. It was inside the Hungarian American Club in Akron, Ohio. And that place, by the way, is haunted. Like, so many times, like, here's the only bad thing I really have to say about the paranormal gathering this year, is there were a lot of borderline closed-minded people. And okay, look, I'm not trying to badmouth anybody's beliefs or anything, but I absolutely refuse to believe that everything is evil. It's just all demons trying to trick you. Absolutely refuse to believe it. I think it's illogical, first of all, and I think it's a very negative aspect. And I think anything with the paranormal is kind of like what you're looking for is what you're going to get. I think if you're expecting negative, that's what you're going to get. And there were quite a few people that believed that everything is negative. Even one guy said that. He said he doesn't believe that every spirit is like a demon or something, but he believes that it's all negative, all of it, because he believes that they're all either trapped or what have you. I absolutely freaking refuse to believe that. And I never will, ever. Because I've seen and heard and gotten proving otherwise. And, you know, he's absolutely entitled to his belief, and I'm not saying that he's wrong exactly. I just believe that he is. And I don't believe in trapped spirits, and I never will. I do not believe for a second that we lose free will just because we die and we're on the other side of life. I can't believe that. Because if I believe that, then I've got to believe that every loved one I have ever lost is trapped. And that's just not ever going to be my belief. I know better. I think they're around because they choose to be. Now, that is not to say that there is not such a thing as trapped spirits. I have dealt with that. But it's not as common as people seem to think. In my experience, anyways. Yeah, and even Jeremy in chat is saying, I don't believe it's all negative. That's just my own experiences. And I agree. I think that's most people, honestly. I think if all they're looking at is negative, 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 then there's probably something wrong with that individual, and they're probably in the wrong line of study, to be brutally honest about it. Because if all you're looking at is negative, 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 if all you believe is that it's all demons just trying to trick you, you have no business being a paranormal investigator. Period. And the reason I say that is very simple. Because investigator, in paranormal investigator, is an operative word. Meaning that if you're just going into haunted places and capturing stuff on film or on a digital recorder or on audio or what have you, then that's not necessarily a paranormal investigator. That's just someone who's enthused by the paranormal. If you're a paranormal investigator, the operative word is investigator. That means doing research, investigating what is there and what is not there. And backing it up by the evidence you collect. Now, me personally, I am a paranormal investigator, but on the other hand, I have no interest at all ever proving it to anybody else other than myself. Because at the end of the day, that's the only person I have to satisfy is me. And I expect that same kind of thought process from everyone on my team. I want them to be satisfied with whatever they catch. And then together as a team, we can be satisfied with it all. But, you know, I do expect them to actually investigate. Like, if you hear a sound, I want you to go and find the source of the sound. Because if it's not paranormal, if it's something natural, we need to know that. You know, or if it is paranormal, we need to know that too. You know, if you see something on film that looks like a spirit, I want you to go check it out and make sure it's actually a spirit and not, you know, just some weird pareidolia from like a shape on the wall. And like, you know, like dust in the paint or something. You know, and I think it's very important to people to be cognizant of the fact that it's a paranormal investigator. You know, and I think there's too many teams out there that are not actually investigating. They're just kind of hobbyists. And I think a lot of these people that are like demonologists, I don't think, honestly, demonologists have any place on a paranormal team. Now, that's not to say I don't appreciate them. I don't believe what they believe for a second. I appreciate the right to believe it. But I don't think they have a place on a team. Because a paranormal investigation team is supposed to be investigating. They're supposed to be scientific. And religious dogma has no place in science. Now, having said that, I'm a self-professed shaman and a paranormal investigator. Two separate things. Now, there are certain aspects of being a shaman that I can bring into a paranormal investigation, and vice versa, but it's still two separate things. I keep those separate for a reason, because I want to investigate. I don't want to push my religious beliefs on other people. And I think, honestly, that's the thing about demonologists that really fucking annoys me, is that they're constantly pushing their beliefs on others. Say, no, it's not the spirit of your grandmother, it's a demon trying to trick you. Is bullshit. I think telling anybody that shit is bullshit. Because all you're doing is you're harboring fear. Which, let's face it, Christianity, since the time of the Inquisition, has basically thrived on. Now, having said that, if you're a Christian, I'm not saying you're wrong, I'm not saying you're stupid, you know, I'm not saying, you know, that you're a fool for believing what you believe, but what I am saying is it needs to be a separate thing. I think pushing your beliefs into the investigation is harmful. Not only to the people that you're dealing with that are alive, but also to the spirits of the dead. Because when you're sitting there telling an innocent spirit that they're evil, I mean, like, how would you feel if, like, you know, somebody came up to you on the street that you didn't even know and accused you of doing shit you had no idea even happened? Seriously, you wouldn't feel too good about it. And that's kind of where I'm going with this, is like that has no place. It doesn't. I'm sorry. It doesn't. If you're a demonologist, then be a demonologist. Don't be a demonologist paranormal investigator, because the two do not mix. They just don't. Or if you are a demonologist and a paranormal investigator, be both, but keep them separate. You know, don't allow your personal beliefs to cloud what the evidence is actually showing you. Believing for a second that all paranormal activity is only one thing is absolutely ridiculous, in my opinion. Sorry, it is. Just like I think people that don't believe in UFOs are idiots. To be perfectly blunt about it, I think they're fucking morons. Because if you think about it logically, the universe is way too big for us to be the only intelligent life in it. That is just complete arrogance to believe that shit. And I think it's the same thing with paranormal investigating. To believe that every spirit is crap, that every spirit is negative, that every spirit is a demon, it is completely fucking arrogant, and it's placing your own ideas on something that isn't there. That's the way I see it. So me and demonologists are never going to agree, ever. Mainly probably because I'm Native American and I'm a shaman, and I know in my heart, in my mind, and in my soul that spirits are just part of the natural world. And not just spirits of the dead, I mean spirits in general. Both good and bad are part of the natural world. It's all about maintaining balance. And, you know, that's just what I believe, and of course people are entitled to believe whatever they want, but just know that if I think you're being a fucking moron, I'm going to call you a fucking moron. And demonologists, to me, honestly, are fucking morons. Most of them. Most of them. I have met a few that are very, very open-minded about it. They actually don't believe that every spirit is a demon, yada, yada, yada. That it's all negative. You know? In fact, one just spoke at our event. Now, I don't agree with demonology. Keep that in mind, personally. But I did like this guy because what he was saying wasn't that every spirit's a demon, like most do. He was saying that the cases that he works on tend to be on the darker side. I appreciated that distinction. I still didn't fully agree with it because he's highlighting the negative. I don't think the negative ever needs to be highlighted. I think when you have to deal with it, you just deal with it. I don't think we have to, like, give it any extra attention at all. I think giving it extra attention is why so much of it seems to be happening lately. Or to put it like how I originally put it, when you expect negative, that's what you're going to get. Because that's what you're looking for. And we don't look for that. We don't. As a team, we don't really look for the good stuff either. It's just that's what we end up with 9 times out of 10. Even in places where you would think it wouldn't exist. Good story actually kind of highlights that point. When I first got this team together, we did an investigation at the Ohio State Reformatory. And I didn't have my whole team with me, but it was my team and myself, and then 7 other teams were there. And they were all provoking, mainly because they're... calling them a paranormal investigation team, in a lot of cases, is really kind of a joke. Because what a lot of these people do is they watch the TV shows and then think they know what to do. And that's just not freaking true. I know what to do because I've been doing it for 25 years. But in any case, they were all provoking because, of course, they saw it on TV and they think that's the thing to do. And then they were all complaining about how they weren't getting any evidence. And I think this applies more to the paranormal probably than anything else. I distinctly remember my grandparents telling me when I was a kid, you catch more flies with honey. And so I applied that kind of thought process to paranormal investigating. And I went in there and nobody else was getting anything. I was kind of amused by it because we were getting a lot of stuff. Mainly because I went in there and said, look, here's the deal, fellows. I know you're here. We want to communicate with you. We don't want to provoke you. We do not want to piss you off. We're just here to communicate. As far as I'm concerned, you served your time. You don't have to be here anymore if you don't want to be. But I think that you do. Probably because... you know, much like the living prisoners today, a lot of them can't handle being out of prison, so they do what they can to end up back in prison. And it's because it becomes their home, it becomes their world, and it's what they can understand. And I think it's the same thing with the spirits there. And we kind of talked about that for a little bit, and got amazing EVPs, got amazing video from that place. It was awesome. We got so much good stuff, it's ridiculous. And, you know, not to mention, like, the shadow figures we were seeing with our naked eye, you know. And, that wasn't just me, it was everybody on the team, basically. And, I don't know, these people are so negative about it all. And I don't think that kind of negativity has any place on an investigation because you're almost guaranteed to not get stuff when you're doing that. I mean... seriously, you don't walk into somebody's house and yell at them. Especially when you don't know them and they're in the living room trying to watch TV. That's a good way to get yourself hurt, first of all. Second of all, it doesn't work. It just pisses them off and then they don't want to talk to you. So, you know, kind of with all that stuff in mind, that's kind of how we approach it. We're just like, look, you know that you're here, we just want to communicate with you, that's it. You know, and we've gotten more world-class evidence that way than... Okay, this is going to sound boastful, but in my heart, I believe that this is actually true. That's why I'm going to say it. Not because I'm trying to brag about me or my team, although I am incredibly proud of both. I think in just our short 2-3 years together as a team, we've got world-class evidence that outshines anything any of the teams on TV have ever gotten in the entire time that they've been on TV. That's my personal opinion. We actually have video, I think it's on YouTube, of a full-bodied apparition. And more than one. We've got full-bodied apparitions on still pictures. Several times. And they call that the Holy Grail. That's like something a lot of investigators spend their entire lifetime trying to get. And a lot of them don't get it. We get them alive. And I think it has a lot to do with how we approach it. You know, we know that the negative's there, but we're not looking for it. You know, and I think when you do everything you can in the paranormal to kind of like be a shining light of hope to spirits, to kind of let them know that you're open to communicating with them, I think you're going to attract many, many, many more of them on an investigation than anyone else. I think when you go into it provoking, that all you're doing is you're like looking at you like, stay away from that crazy person. Because that's probably what they're thinking you are, is out of your fucking mind. And honestly, I don't blame them. I would think the same thing too. I honestly, if somebody came into my house yelling at me the way a lot of these guys do on investigations, somebody would be liable to get shot. And I definitely wouldn't be talking to them. You know, I'm just saying, keep that in mind. I mean, I know negative stuff is out there. I've had to deal with it. I've done house hauntings, a lot of them. 430 successful ones to date, and never once had to be called back. You know, I think the reason for that is because I have absolute faith in my abilities. And I think if you have any doubt at all, that leaves a little chink in the armor. But, you know, that's a topic for a different night. Anyways, I don't think for a second it's all negative or anything. So I didn't agree with a couple of the speakers that were there. Yeah, exactly. Jeremy just said it. Always be nice. A little respect goes a long way. And, so I didn't agree with some of the speakers who were there. But I certainly appreciated, you know, their right to have those opinions. I just don't agree with them, you know. And one of them, I was like, oh my God, I want to kill this guy. But that was more about his attitude about it all, you know, than anything. He seemed to be more of a close-minded person, to be honest with you, which, you know, you kind of think, how can somebody be close-minded and be a paranormal investigator? But it does happen. And he was just one of those types where it's all negative, period, I don't care what anybody says, type of people. And, you know, I definitely don't agree with that. But, you know, I respect his right to have that opinion. I just don't necessarily respect the way he voiced it, I guess. But yeah, respect is a big deal. You know, I think if you respect the spirits you're dealing with, you're going to get a lot farther than people that are just going in there and going, look, try and fucking scare me, blah, blah, blah. You know, and just doing all that stupid shit. I don't think provoking is ever okay, to be honest. with the exception of if I know I'm dealing with something dark and evil, you know, like a demon, provoking is okay at that point, because provoking actually shows that you're not afraid of it. And you can't fear those things, because that's what they feed on. So, you know, that's the exception to the rule. In my eyes, anyways. But other than that, I don't really provoke, like, ever. I think the closest I've gotten to it is, like, issued warnings where, like, someone's not necessarily negative, but they're like, doing something to, like, one of my investigators. I'll get a little upset sometimes and go, look, you need to fucking back off. That kind of thing. But I still don't consider that, like, provoking, because it's just a statement, and then it's over. It's not like I'm telling them to do stuff or, you know, whatever. But, you know, that's just my thoughts on it. I don't think that anyone is going to get very far by provoking. And by provoking, I'm talking about the people that are yelling at spirits to try and get results. I think that's a lousy method, to be honest with you. Now, historical provocation, that's different. Because historical provocation is like a good example is like Gettysburg, right? If I go to Gettysburg dressed as a Confederate soldier, and I'm yelling at the Union soldiers to try and shoot me, or like I'm turning myself in, you know, kind of thing, I think that's going to get a lot of results, because those spirits have a tendency, in my opinion, to be semi-residual. What I mean by semi-residual is they're actually intelligent spirits, but they're kind of caught in the loop of this big historical moment. And so, they can have intelligent interaction, but at the same time, they still have to, you know, play by the same rules, so to speak. So, historical provocation is a very different thing. It's not really provoking, actually, in my book, but that's just what they call it. I'm a big fan of trigger objects. Both historical trigger objects, like, will be a good one. Actually, a good example of that is some of the items that they auctioned off. There was recently a location called the Emmett House. You may have seen it on Ghost Adventures or on Ghost Hunters. That recently burned down. And they were doing kind of like this raffle thing at the paranormal gathering, and some of the things that they were raffling were pieces of the building that had survived the fire, because the building's not there anymore. And they were very conscious of it. They were even going, look, are you okay with having a piece of haunted building? Realizing that there might be something attached to it. And, you know, but it was cool, you know, because it was, all the proceeds from the raffle were actually going for preservation of as yet to be decided historical haunted site. So, you know, that's awesome. But, yeah, so, it, all in all, it was an awesome event. And there was just, like, two speakers I didn't necessarily agree with. There was one guy that was really good. He's from, I think he was from Tri-C Ghost Hunters. And I believe they're out of Columbus, Cincinnati, something. I don't remember. But, he was talking about how orbs aren't real. You know, like most orbs can be explained away, which I happen to agree with. I do, however, know that orbs are, there are such a thing as spirit orbs. They're just rare. Most people don't see them. I think if you see it with the naked eye, it could be something explainable, depending on how it moves. I think it, if it moves in an intelligent way, that's an orb. Period. Because dust, moisture particles, and the like obviously have no intelligence. So, but I do think that they are rare in the larger scheme of things. I think if you have a picture of like a thousand orbs in a room, I think probably what you're looking at is dust or rain or moisture or whatever. But I think if you have a picture that's just one orb and it's super bright, not like it's just simply reflecting light, like it's generating light of its own, that's an orb. You know, but they're rare. They are rare. So I had to give it to him. He went a step further, I think, and stated that, in his belief, 99% of them are explained away. And to me, it's 98. So not a big difference there. But I did basically agree with him, just not on everything he said, and that's fine. You know, I think that's a good thing about conventions and like the paranormal gathering and stuff. And I think every area should have a paranormal gathering, by the way. Is so that you can appreciate the differences. You know, I think that's very important. You know, if I teach, you know, people how to be better cameramen or to be more aware of their surroundings, or if they can learn anything from me, then great. I've done my job. But like I've said before on my show, you know, I can't change their mind, but all I can hope to do is open. And if I've achieved at least them thinking about it, then I've done my job. You know, so, yeah. And, you know, I'm a big believer in, the spirit world. You know, I've lived with it since I was 5 years old. It's hard for me not to. But I'm also very aware of things like pareidolia and you know, misidentification and things of that aspect, where I'm very, very good at debunking my own stuff. Because, and this is something I always say, I am a believer, but I investigate like a skeptic. And I think any good investigator should investigate that way, because while it's good to have the initial belief, it's good to debunk your own stuff. However, I'm not interested in proving it to anyone other than myself, so I'm probably not on as hard on my evidence is maybe somebody that wants a outright TV deal. I'm just not. But you know, that's me. And you know, I'm aware that we're not all the same, but and it's not people's differences of opinion that I necessarily have a hard time with. What I have a hard time with more than anything is the kind of, for lack of a better way of putting it, the total fucking arrogance that comes with saying it's all negative, period. And not being open to any other interpretation. I think that's ridiculous. I think seeing things in black and white does not have a place in paranormal investigating, because it's all gray. You know, it's good, it's bad, it's everything in between. You know, you're gonna have nights when you're investigating and maybe you only have one piece of evidence to show for the entire night, if at all. You know, never happened to us. We've never walked away from an investigation empty-handed. But like I said, but we always are aware that it is a possibility. You know, there may come a time when we do an investigation and get nothing, because yeah, I think when that does happen, it'll probably be because everybody that went in there before us has provoked them to hell and back. And therefore, they're just absolutely disgusted with everybody. And we haven't run into that yet, but, you know, I'm aware that it is a possibility that, you know, someday maybe we won't get something to show for it. And that's okay. Because so far in 3 years, that's never happened once. That's an amazing track record. Most teams, including the teams on TV, have, like, a lot of what you see on TV, what a lot of people don't know is, like you're only seeing like an hour or 2 hours of them being there. But like with ghost hunters, they typically are in that location for a week. And what you're actually seeing is just the stuff they caught. And it's the same for Ghost Adventures. They spend a lot of time there before they have enough to actually show on TV. We don't do that. You know, we may go back to the same place over and over again, like we do with the Fire Museum. There for a while, we were practically every weekend. But we don't spend like a week in a place. You know, we spend like probably 4 hours there, typically. Because we can't start until like after bingo lets out at 10 during a weeknight or 9:30 on a Saturday. You know, and then we only go until about 2 a.m. because then we've got like an hour and a half drive back home. You know, and you know, that we've gotten more stuff in that short amount of time than these guys typically get in a week. That may sound braggadocious, but you know, it's the truth. And I think it has a lot to do with the fact that we don't see it all as negative. We don't provoke. In fact, the spirit I was talking about earlier, this guy Donnie, we go into that soda shop and set up a, yeah, exactly. Jeremy said it, that's a shit ton of evidence for that short of a time period. Exactly. And here's the thing, like we'll go into that soda shop and talk to Donnie just like he's a normal person. And I think they appreciate that. You know, and because they appreciate it, they're more apt to communicate with us than they would be like Joe Schmo that's in there yelling and screaming at the top of his lungs to come scare me or whatever. And you know, and the cool thing is because we've developed that reputation of being, you know, understanding and not provoking, every time we go back to this place, and we've gone there pretty regularly for 3 years now, we are, not only are getting stuff that, like every single time, we're learning more. Every time we go back there, we're learning something new. Yeah, exactly. Jerry said it in chat. Some people pay big dollars and never get squat. And that's absolutely true. And that brings up another issue, actually. Places have been on TV that are extremely paranormal with all these paranormal groups, like the Ohio State Reformatory, for example. And I'm not saying that's not a good location, but I've been there one time, and that was enough for me. And the reason that was enough for me isn't because there was anything initially wrong with the place. It's because I have an understanding that that place has been investigated to death. No pun intended. Like, it literally has. Like there's less and less activity there all the time because there's constantly people there investigating. You know, and it's got to be very tiring for the spirits there. Has to be. You know, I mean, if you think about it, how tiring would it be, you know, you're trying to kick back and relax in your home, but every single night of the week, somebody's coming in yelling at you. That would get very emotionally tiring after a while. And so I think the activity there is actually decreasing because of that. Yeah. And yeah, exactly. Jeremy said talk about tortured souls. Exactly. I agree. I don't like provoking at all, and I have no reservations about holding back my opinion about that. Never have. And yeah, so, you know, I think it's about our approach. I think they appreciate that we're not doing that stuff, and that we're talking to them like they're human beings instead of, you know, like a demon or something, you know, evil or just yelling at them or whatever. And that's not to say I don't believe evil exists, because I know for a fact that it does. I've dealt with it 430 times. Because when I cleanse a house, I'm not cleansing it of every spirit. I'm cleansing it only of evil. And I've even told clients this, that I only get rid of evil spirits because the good spirits have just as much right to be here as you do. In fact, in some cases, more. I'm not gonna tell, like for example, I did a case not too long ago where I'm like, look, I'm gonna cleanse your house. I can't guarantee there will be no spirits here, but anything evil would be gone. And it turned out that one of the spirits there that wasn't evil, one of the good spirits, is a Cherokee warrior on what used to be Cherokee land. He's got more right to be there than anybody, as far as I'm concerned. And I'm very upfront about that. And I tell them, you know, be very open to communicating with them. They'll actually appreciate it if you're not provoking. If you just talk to them like a person. And, so far, 430 house cleansings later, I've never once had to have been called back for any of them. The only one I've ever semi been called back, and I say semi, is my investigator, Becky, who actually lives right across the street from me. I've had to do her house twice now, but it was actually two separate entities. It wasn't the same thing. So, I don't count that as a callback. It's just dealing with two similar situations. I believe that spirits do get tortured by all that provoking. I really do. And, oh, sure. I do those a lot, actually. I do a lot of house cleansings. And it's a free service. I absolutely will never charge for it. The only exception to that rule would be if it was like a big commercial building. Because I use Sage Smoke. I may have to charge something just to replenish my stock. But just for that. Or at most maybe for gas if it's like far from here. But other than that, I don't ever charge for house cleansing, ever. I might for like big commercial building, maybe. But other than that, yeah, we don't charge for that. We do charge for like private and public ghost hunts, with the exception of the Mansfield Bar Museum. That is all free, because it's a non-profit organization. So, only thing we do ask for is people to donate. There's actually a donation jar that helps them, you know, do what they need to do to keep things going. But other than that, yeah. And unlike a lot of these places, these teams that run these places, actually, our prices are reasonable. Like to go hunt at the Ohio State Reformatory, it's like $70 per person. I would never charge that. The most I would ever charge for any building would be $50, and that's based on size. Okay, and one of the biggest buildings that we're possibly going to get is in Springfield, Ohio, which is about 3 hours away from me. It's called the Crowell Collier Building, and you can actually look this up online and look at pictures of it. It's a big industrial building. It was originally, I think it was a print works originally, but the last owner was like this kind of eccentric wealthy guy, and that building was like a warehouse for Harley Davidson parts distribution, you know, like customization parts and stuff like that. And but that building is almost 1 million square feet. The Ohio State Reformatory could fit into that building twice. It's actually bigger than Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum. It's huge. It really is. And we spent like 6-7 hours there and saw maybe a third of the building. So, I mean, massive, massive building. And extremely haunted. Extremely honored. Me and I actually don't know if this guy's still an investigator with our team or not. It's hard to tell because he lives in Springfield, which is, you know, it's so far away. We don't hardly ever see him, but we still love the guy. His name's Danny, and he lives out there. And we were up on the third floor in this one section that's kind of like it's a full floor, but then there's like a catwalk, so it's almost 2 floors tall, but it's only 1 floor. And it's up on the third floor, and we were down below the catwalk, walking back towards where we had set up for the night. And both me and Danny, with our naked eyes, saw this light anomaly come off of the catwalk, sink down to the ground, and go right past our feet. And amazing, amazing place. And later on, there's like this breezeway that, because it's actually not just one building, it's actually, well, there is like one building that goes around kind of like horseshoe shaped, and then there's other buildings in the middle, and there's breezeways that connect all the buildings. And I was going down this breezeway, and I was right at the other end of the breezeway, and all of a sudden, visibly with my naked eye, there was an orb, a bright, bright white, kind of like bluish orb, about yay big, dropped down, like literally this far in front of my face. And, you know, unfortunately, I didn't capture it on film because my camera, the battery had just died. Like, spirits were sucking my battery dry all night, driving me nuts. But that place is insane, and that's like the typical for us. You know, isn't just, I don't mean like the size, but like the kind of activity that's typical for us, because I think they know we're not there to make them uncomfortable. You know, as long as they're not messing with us, we're fine. And we saw a ton of shadow figures. Like, everybody that was there that night saw shadow figures. It was crazy. And then another building we're probably going to get to investigate at some point is actually right across the street. It's called the Robinson Building. It was originally a recycling center kind of place. Like, but it's pretty big, and evidently it's like 7 stories tall or something like that. Has a ton of activity in it. And there's another team that actually owns that building, and they actually have a ghost hunting shop inside the first floor of the building. So we're trying to work out a deal where they come to the fire museum, and then we go there. So we'll get to investigate that sometime, I imagine. But yeah, it's just I think it's our approach, really. I really do. I think it's because we don't provoke, and we don't go out of our way to like yell and scream at them and all that silly nonsense. I think they appreciate it, and so they're more apt to communicate with us. Really, the only concern that we have is that things don't follow us home. That's pretty much it, because like, they get to like us too much, they might try and come home with us. Oh yeah, there's a lot of them, actually. Well, especially in Ohio, because there's so many haunted places in Ohio that paranormal investigating's gotten really big here. Not so much in Springfield, but you know, like in my area, there's probably 150 teams, and none of them are like us, which I think is really cool. You know, so like we do inhabit like kind of this unique spot, I guess. And I am going to brag a little bit. We are, I'm pretty sure, the only team in our area that is on ParanormalSocieties.com, which is a huge deal. For those that don't know, ParanormalSocieties.com is a huge thing. Like, huge. Like, ghost hunters and ghost adventurers haven't even been able to get on there until relatively recently. And they actually are one of the main sponsors of Fear Fest, the largest paranormal convention you know, basically in the world. Well, it's a paranormal horror convention, actually, but, yeah, they are actually one of the sponsors there, and it's amazing. Like, and a lot of good stuff's been happening since we've made it on that site. A lot of people are getting interested, which you can't tell by tonight, because usually I have a much bigger audience than just my good friend Jerry here, but, in chat, used to have him, like, around 10 to 15 people, I think, so, yeah, but hopefully, you know, people will still watch this. Oh, yeah, I'm sure people listen to the podcast. I know they do. Not this last one, but the one I did before that, I think it was the Hollywood Undead Part 2, had like 160 views. So I must be doing something right. And I'm fine with that. I know people have to work and you know, real life gets in the way and all that stuff, but yeah, we do usually have a lot more people in chat, so, but I'm not discouraged at all, so don't take that as like a dig, it's not, but yeah, you know, I really think that, I think we're a superior team, you know, and I'm not saying that to be boastful, I'm just saying, you know, based on the things we get and the way that we work together. I think we're a really, really strong, really superior team. And I think if I ever were to step down, I don't think it would be the same. You know, as the founder of the team and kind of like the lead investigator, I don't think it would be the same, honestly, without me. And I'm not saying that to be boastful, because that's not really how I mean it. It's just that I don't think anybody else would have the same ideas as I do. And, you know, that's kind of a good thing. You know, and I'm always telling people on my team, if you want to go do your own thing, you have my blessing. Go do your own thing. You know, so, yeah, it's just really good. Like, the stuff we get is just, it constantly blows my mind, because I think we are so different, you know. I'm starting to see more teams become a little bit like us, and you know, I don't want to say that it's because of us, but it wouldn't surprise me either. And mostly that's because I think more and more teams are starting to realize that provoking isn't necessarily the way to go. And, yeah, so. But I do definitely, I get a lot from other teams, though, too. And I think that's the other thing that kind of separates us, is like, I'll hear things that another team's doing and think, we should try that. You know, just to see how it goes. And I'm always open to, what's the word I'm looking for? Innovation. And I enjoy working with other teams, too. You know, I think it's good to be collaborative on stuff, and like I just answered questions for one of the teams I met at the paranormal gathering on Saturday. This artifact was found inside somebody's wall, and there was questions about it, and I gave them a pretty good idea of what it is. And that's kind of another specialty of mine, by the way, is especially if they're like from a primitive, so-called primitive society, like Native Americans or you know, like tribal African or Aboriginal or what have you. Certain artifacts are very recognizable to me. And have become that way through like painstaking research. So I was very happy to lend a hand, and he even brought up the idea of doing some investigations together. And I'm very open to that. But having said that, I do things a certain way, and my team does things a certain way, and we're always going to do it that way. There's always room for growth, but I think the day that we provoke is probably the day we end as a team, because I don't think that's ever going to happen, to be honest. So yeah, anyways, that is about it for me, folks. Tune in on Monday. Hopefully, I'm going to have a co-host on Monday with Miss Reagan James, but we'll see how things go with her new job and stuff. But it should be good show. I'm going to do another live EVP session on the air, as well as play some of the EVPs that we caught on our most recent investigation. So definitely tune into that. And then Wednesday, I'm hoping that I'm going to have a special guest on the show, but we're going to see how that goes too. All right, until next time, my pack. Peace out.